A quick 1 minute summary on cognitive functional therapy for the treatment of non-specific chronic low back pain. And this article actually had two different treatment groups. There was the cognitive functional therapy group and then also an exercise plus manual therapy group. And there was a 3-year follow-up for this study. And what they found at the end of 3 years was that between the two groups, there was actually no difference in pain intensity. However, for disability, they found that the cognitive functional therapy group actually had reduced disability compared to the exercise plus manual therapy group. And the results are interesting because typically long-term follow-up, we typically don't see these results holding up in the long term. However, this study specifically found that the cognitive functional therapy group actually has a long-term effect when it comes to disability. But let's take a look at the details of the study a little bit more in depth. This article was by Fersum, and it was published in the European Journal of Pain. It was a randomized control trial with two different treatment groups. There was the cognitive functional therapy group, and it was compared to a manual therapy plus exercise group. And for those who aren't familiar with what cognitive functional therapy is, it's a treatment approach that kind of takes the biopsychosocial approach and applies it to low back pain specifically. And so it's divided into three different categories. The first category is the making sense of pain. And what they do is they look to dispel any myths that are thought of by the patient about either chronic low back pain or pain in general. And so it kind of helps to frame the patient's perspective on what they're currently dealing with. The second stage is exposure with control, and so this is actually divided into two subcategories where there's a functional movement stage where they're going through different exercises specific to the patient, whatever they said they're either fearful of or there's pain that they're experiencing with that movement. And they modify the movements so that the patient can do those movements. So if they have pain with bending forward, they tweak the movement so that they can bend forward again in a kind of like a graded exposure model. And then the second part of the exposure with control stage is that they integrate that into daily life. And so they use these techniques that were taught so that the person can use them throughout the day, so they're not either having pain with whatever they were having pain with before, or they're not fearful of doing that movement. And then the third stage is just lifestyle change. And so basically the emphasis is on trying to get the patient to be more active in some capacity, depending on if they weren't active before, getting them to be active, or if what they were doing was painful before, changing what they're doing so that way they can continue to be physically active while still managing their pain. Both the cognitive functional therapy group and the manual therapy plus exercise group, the treatment was performed over 12 weeks, and the average treatments for each were 7.7 treatment visits in that 12 weeks for the cognitive functional therapy group, and then for the manual therapy plus exercise, it was 8 visits in that 12-week period. And what this study found was that, well, first of all, there was a lot of dropout, as you would expect in a study that has a 3-year follow-up. For the cognitive functional therapy group, I think the study started off with 62 individuals, and then for the manual therapy plus exercise group, there was 59 individuals. At the 3-year follow-up, there was 31 that followed up for the cognitive functional therapy group, and then 29 for the manual therapy plus exercise group. So there was quite a lot of dropout in this study for various reasons. But the results of this study, when looking at disability, was that the cognitive functional therapy group had a superior result compared to the manual therapy plus exercise group at that 3-year follow-up. The effect size was 6.6, which was measured on an Oswestry disability index. And that's rated as a moderate effect size. And so they found that there was a difference in disability compared to the two groups and a long-term follow-up. However, when they looked at pain, there was no difference between the two treatment groups. And when looking at the results of the study, there are a couple things that I find very interesting. And one of them is that I think it's awesome that we have a treatment approach that seems to have some sort of long-term outcome when looking at disability. The cognitive functional therapy group seemed to have an impact 3 years following treatment. And after only roughly 8 treatments, I think that's pretty good. However, when actually looking at the data, it's interesting because disability wasn't zero. I think when they looked at the Oswestry scores, the mean score was about 10 out of 50, and so there was still some disability. And while it's definitely decreased from what the patient had come in with, it's still not zero, and so it doesn't seem that they fully resolved function 3 years after the initial treatment. But then also when we look at pain, there was still pain in both treatment groups, and so it's one of those things where it's great that we're able to either reduce disability associated with chronic low back pain and reduce pain intensity as well, but we're actually not really, we're managing it versus actually solving it. And I think one of the interesting parallels is like if we look at like having like a cold or something like that, where, you know, you can be as diligent as you need to be to try not to get sick. Wash your hands, you know, cover your mouth, stay away from other people who are sick, you know, doing all those kind of things. But every once in a while, you just happen to get sick. And I think that's similar with low back pain. We can kind of try to do all the things, make sure we're exercising, being strong, you know, trying to lift in the most advantageous positions. But every once in a while, we're going to get low back pain. It seems to be very hard to actually prevent, similar to preventing getting sick. But if we were sick at one point, and then 3 years afterwards, we still had the same cough, or we're still running a fever, or still having a runny nose, That wouldn't be great. And so even though these therapies, either manual therapy plus exercise or cognitive functional therapy, seem to be effective at least in the short term and then maybe a little bit in the longer term, there still seems to be a lot more that we actually need to figure out to actually create long-term strategies that are effective. The second part that I found that was interesting on this article is that they actually mentioned this kind of separation of function and pain. And so when we looked at the study and the results for the cognitive functional therapy group, the disability seemed to keep decreasing even though pain was relatively the same. And so it's interesting to kind of think of, because typically we think that pain is the reason why somebody isn't doing something. They aren't, you know, bending over to pick something off of the ground because they have low back pain, or they're not running or exercising at the gym because of the low back pain. But when it comes to chronic low back pain, it doesn't seem like those things run together, that pain and disability are together. Eventually they kind of split. And I find that just very interesting, because it kind of is counterintuitive to what we think of pain causing the disability. They don't seem to be as related as commonly thought. And this is interesting because when we look at some of the other research, these findings that we see in this study don't seem to be isolated, in that in a lot of other studies there seems to be some level of pain after somebody receives treatment. But when we look at satisfaction scores, they tend to report that they're satisfied with the treatment that they receive despite still having pain. And so maybe the goal of treatment isn't necessarily complete resolution of pain, and that would define a successful treatment. Instead, we should look at functional improvements, because as function tends to improve, that seems to be more related to increased satisfaction reported with treatment.